when the government was elected, it had promised that it would have no new top-down reorganisation of the NHS, and I was very pleased about that. I've been a GP for 20 years and there have been many, many reorganisations, and they tend to be very disruptive. They stop you being able to get on with your work, and often very expensive, and don't really achieve what they were supposed to achieve. So I was really shocked when I heard that the government was going to bring in new NHS reforms. I love my job. I enjoy trying to provide good patient care. And of course, I'm aware that GPs have to have an overview of other things, like the kinds of services their patients are getting. GPs will be organised in large organisations called GP Consortia, and we'll be putting out tenders to say, okay, who's going to provide cardiology services or diabetes services or whatever, and different companies can then bid and compete against local NHS hospitals to provide those services. The government says that quality is still important, but because quality is a very difficult thing to measure, it's the cheaper services that tend to win the contracts, and that they win it on price, not on quality. GP Consortia will be under a lot of pressure to choose the cheapest bid. One senior doctor, who is actually a supporter of these reforms, has said that every GP surgery is going to have to reduce the costs of what they spend on patients by £2,500 a day. So in a context of £20 billion worth of cuts over the next 4 years, what's going to happen is that the GP consortia are the ones that are supposed to be making those cuts. They will have to buy in cheaper services for patients, and they will also be policing individual GP practices and GPs like me and telling us that we need to cut our referrals, cut our prescribing, cut the number of patients that use hospital services, cut the number of tests we do in order to save money. That's going to start eroding into or eating into our clinical decision making. At the moment, I do try not to be wasteful and overuse NHS resources, which is quite right. And if a patient, for example, says they want an X-ray, I'll be able to persuade them to say, you know, I don't think you need an X-ray, it's not going to give us any extra information, and it will expose you to radiation unnecessarily, so I wouldn't recommend it now. Now, with my patients, when I give them that explanation, they generally think, okay, the doctor's explained to me why she doesn't think this test is necessary, and they believe that it's a clinical decision made in their interest. Even if I try very hard to do the best for my patients, I wonder if they will start to suspect that I'm not making decisions in their best interest, and I'm beginning to allow financial considerations to creep into the doctor-patient relationship. And so much of our work is based on trust. People trust us with their lives, with so much that they need to, they open up to us, and they hope that we're going to make the right decisions for them. And if they start thinking that we're not doing that, I think it could undermine the very core of general practice, the very core of what I do every day. And that really worries me. If we overspend, we'll be penalised financially. We may even lose our contracts to run our GP practice, lose our jobs. So there'll be real pressure on us to stay within budget. If towards the end of the financial year we're reaching our budget limit, we may end up not referring patients for a couple of months till we get into the new financial year. The NHS reforms have been sold as involving local GPs and decision making. I doubt that I will have much of a say, and I think the decisions will all be taken by a small group of entrepreneurial GPs working alongside managers, maybe private company managers, to tell us what we should be doing. There's the whole thing of competition, which I think is difficult for people to really understand, because we don't think of the NHS as a marketplace with lots of competing organisations. It will undermine the collaboration that already exists between GPs and hospitals and other healthcare providers to try to discuss how we can make services even better for patients. And I've been involved in a lot of collaboration in the last few years that has been really effective. So, for example, if we have a patient that's perhaps got a sore knee, in the past we might have referred them to see an orthopaedic surgeon, which would not really have been appropriate because often knee problems don't require surgery. Local GPs have been collaborating with the local hospital and with physiotherapists and with foot specialists to provide a better service where we can refer people to be seen quickly at the local hospital within a month, and they can see either a specialist or a specialist physiotherapist to assess their problem. If it looks like they might need to see a surgeon, they can be referred, but mostly they can be given advice, they can be given physiotherapy, and they can be then sent back to the GP with appropriate follow-up. So that gives a much simpler, quicker service, and that's a result of a collaborative approach. Explicitly rule out collaborative relationships between GPs and hospitals and other healthcare providers. The private company can appeal to an organisation called Monitor and say, we are objecting to the fact that these GPs have been in discussions with the local hospital to provide a service because we didn't get a look-in, that's anti-competitive and we're going to challenge that. The Monitor has been set up by the government specifically for that purpose. Its role is to promote competition, and it's there as a kind of court of appeal for private companies who are not happy with local NHS hospitals continuing to get the contracts to provide care. Many of my GP colleagues who think these reforms might be able to work say, you know, don't worry, we won't be giving the contracts to private companies, so why are you worried? And I say, well, you won't have any choice. You'll be legally obliged to tender, and you'll be legally obliged to be transparent about how you offer the contract. If someone comes along and does it cheaper and claims it's the same quality, you would have to go for that contract. There are huge multinationals with billions of dollars to spend on bidding for services, and what they generally do is they do a thing called loss leading. They put in a really low bid, they take the loss because they can afford it, so they get the contract. And then, once they've cornered the market, their prices start to go up. But also, in order to provide services more cheaply, in order to have profits to give to private shareholders, you need to drive down the costs of providing the service. And the main way you do it in healthcare is to cut staff. And lots of international research shows that where there is a profit-making company providing care, the quality and standards tends to be lower. Because you contract with a provider of healthcare for maybe 2 years or for 5 years, and unless you've got very good grounds, it's difficult to pull out of that contract. It's very difficult to find out about the performance of private providers of healthcare because of a thing called commercial confidentiality. So you cannot just go in and say, okay, let's look at your results, let's look at your standards, let's see if we're getting value for money. We'll have to employ lawyers who are expensive, and there'll be probably lots of challenges to our decisions. Again, very expensive. We'll have to be very careful that we monitor all these contracts in detail. There'll be billing, there'll be invoicing. All these things are called transaction costs. And the estimate is that transaction costs are going to rise to about 20% of the NHS budget, which is about £20 billion a year. That would be the transaction costs, because the NHS budget's about £100 billion a year. It starts to mount up and becomes close to what they have in the United States. which is 20 to 30% of their budget spent on administration and transaction costs. And in about 20 years ago or so, before any of these market reforms were introduced initially, the NHS administration costs were only 5%. So 5% is what a unified organisation providing care should expect to be paying. It's going to waste money, and there'll be less money available for frontline services, and therefore more cuts will have to be made. There's no evidence at all that that quality of care is improved with competition. In fact, if you look at the United States, which is the most competitive healthcare market in the world, the United States has a higher infant mortality rate, higher maternal mortality rate, lower life expectancy, and poorer outcomes for a range of diseases than the UK. And research within the United States has looked at the profit-making healthcare providers, and even in the United States there are non-profit-making healthcare providers. Comparing the two and looking at quality standards, the quality of care is much better in the non-profit-making healthcare organisations. So that's the evidence from international healthcare research, and that's something which Cameron and Lansley don't want to talk about. This didn't happen overnight. The private healthcare business has been lobbying for 20 years to open up the NHS market to their services in order to make profit. It's not true that it's come from GPs or that it's a grassroots movement at all. It is a top-down, it's been imposed by the government. The fact that some GPs are getting involved at this early stage in trying to develop consortia does not mean that they actually support them or that it came from them in the first place. It's needs must, and it's been forced on them. Hospital trusts will be able to make as much money as they can from private patients. At the moment there's a cap, and that cap is to be removed. That will mean there'll be fewer services, fewer beds available for NHS patients. And that, I think, will mean longer waiting lists, longer waiting times for NHS patients. In addition, the government has removed the NHS waiting time targets, which actually were very effective in making sure that patients were seen and treated within 3 months of referral, 3 to 4 months of referral. And now that those targets have been removed, we've already seen waiting times. In the last 8 months, the waiting times have increased by 25% already, and growing. I think we're going to get back to the state we were in at the end of Thatcher's time in Parliament, at the end of before Labour came in, when the waiting times were phenomenal. You could wait for a year and a half to 2 years to get a hip replacement. And that was really hard. I remember an elderly lady who was in terrible pain from her hip. And her daughter used to come and plead with me, can she get seen quicker? I used to write letters to the consultants, to the hospital, saying, why is this woman still waiting? She can't sleep, she's in terrible pain, she's on painkillers all the time. And they just said, well, you know, she's on the waiting list. And this was a year and a half later, she actually died before she had her operation. And that could have made the last couple of years of her life actually a lot more comfortable, a lot less painful. So I don't want ever to go back to that situation. I really feel that we're going to get there again. The everyday experience of dealing with patients will be encroached upon by the need to think about money all the time. We must defend the NHS. We've grown up in the NHS. I was born after the NHS was founded. I was trained in the NHS. My knowledge has come from NHS patients who have helped me to become a doctor. And I feel very much part of the NHS family. And I just can't imagine a future where the NHS has just become a logo, a brand name that any private company can use to provide services, and our job as GPs is to choose which one we're supposed to be sending our patients to.